keen on this whole concept of skeptics in the pub or the library or wherever we are, for many reasons, not least it brings together a lot of people with different knowledges and interests to think about the things that I'm interested in, but also because within a week of my being sacked by the government, the Westminster Skeptics in the Pub asked me to come and talk there, and that was my first exposure to a sort of a public audience interested in what had happened to me, and that was actually a very positive experience, because at first I realised I could talk in public, and second, actually most people were interested in what I had to say. So I've been doing a few of these. Who am I? Well, I'm a psychiatrist, as I like to say, with a name like Nutt. There are other careers in medicine, but as the men of you will think, but as I get to, at my age, definitely psychiatry is more interesting than those. I'm a researcher for about 30 years. I went into medicine to research the brain, and I've been very fortunate. I've managed to do that over the last 30, 40 years now, and I've published quite a bit of scientific publications, books. This is the latest one, which I'll tell you about in a minute. And I've worked in the USA and Australia, but mostly in the UK. I've had four children. The youngest one actually graduated last week, so I've sort of hopefully been through the worst. But I've seen an awful lot of things through those teenage years. Certainly things I didn't expect, definitely things I didn't want. But things that have actually made me a bit wiser and a bit more sensitive about and sympathetic to what teenagers do. But of course, the reason you know of me, the only reason any of you heard of me really, apart from my friends in the front row here, is that I am the ex-government drugs advisor. I spent 9 years chairing the scientific committee of the ACND. They made decisions about the harms of drugs. And then I was promoted to become chair of council, the chair of the ACND. And I managed to sustain that for about a year before they sacked me, almost on the anniversary, actually. And that's what you know of me. So here is the front page of the week. Brilliant caricature of my sacking, for all sorts of reasons. Makes me look younger, I think. There's one error in it, of course, which is the white coat. Psychiatrists don't wear white coats, but the media insists that scientists wear white coats. I managed to find one big enough, so now I got a white coat. This is the book of cannabis falling from my hand. The key element of this caricature are the scales of justice here, because that sums up the debate. On the one side, we have beer and fags, and on the other side, we have strange green-looking chemicals in plastic bags. We don't know what they are. I don't know what they are. Actually, no one knows what they are, which is part of the problem. But the debate is, which is worse? But this is a remarkable front page because of the extraordinary coincidence of this up here. Andrew Agassi's crystal meth confession. Some of you obviously know who Andre Agassi is, he was. And he was a Wimbledon tennis champion in the 90s. And soon after he won Wimbledon, he tested positive for crystal meth, which is methamphetamine. And that presented the tennis authorities with an enormous problem, because their rules say that if you test positive for a banned substance, you ban for a minimum of 2 years, and you can't be banned for life. And banning the Wimbledon champion would actually create certain problems for the sport, not least of which they'd lose a huge amount of media money. So they thought long and hard about what to do, and then they came up with what I think is a rather English solution. They decided to ask him to tell the truth. Andre, did you actually take crystal meth? And he said, of course not. You know, your tests are obviously just rubbish. You know, I've never touched this stuff. And they sort of, oh, great, well, go away and be a good boy and play more tennis. And he did. And then some 20 years later, he decided to share the truth with us. And I don't know whether he was burdened down by this guilt for all those years I lied, or whether his publisher said, look, you know, put the juicy bits into the book and you'll sell a few million more copies, probably the latter. Anyway, he told the truth. He had taken the drug, and he had lied, and he got away with it. And of course, some cynical people think he got away with it simply because he was rich and famous and he was too big to fail. You know, that's a strange concept. We haven't heard of it for some reason, have we? But anyway, but the fact is, he's on that page, front page with me, because people were all interested. People will read magazines if famous people talk about drug taking. So that emphasizes the ambivalence we have in society. We ban it, we can destroy people's careers, mine, maybe, certainly Agassiz if he was caught taking drugs. But as a society, we're fascinated by drugs. So why was I sacked? Well, it's still not clear, I think, because probably at the time they didn't really know, but it was just seemed like a good thing on the day. But when they had to justify what they did, they said things like, I was getting involved in policy, and I was saying, well, as their chief scientific advisor, this policy is supposed to be a scientifically based policy, and if it's not, then it's probably unjust. They said I was getting mixed messages, and what I was saying was, we had just banned GHB, so that was one of the drugs, one of the number of drugs got banned on my watch on the ACMD. But I said, look, it's all right banning GHB, but do remember that alcohol is pretty similar to GHB. So if it was alcohol was invented today, it would probably be banned. But they didn't like that. That was complicated. And I also said, and this is what they really hate, that alcohol was more harmful than cannabis. And then they said they'd lost confidence in me, which of course is political speak for the fact I wouldn't toe the line. So let's start with a bit of science. Let's discuss what is a drug and who should say what a drug is. Well, I like the political definitions of a drug, and that's this one. I really do feel sorry for Jackie Smith because, it really must be. She obviously wanted to get into the Labour Party, didn't she, to smoke cannabis at Oxford, even though she didn't enjoy it. And David Cameron, he did lots of things when young that he shouldn't have. We all did. By that, the we, by the way, refers to all the Oxonians and mostly old Etonians on the front bench. And he won't tell us what he did, but actually I know, and I'm going to share that with you later on. Some MPs are honest. I like Tim Yeo. Tim Yeo is a man of very wide tastes in different aspects of life, like women and cannabis. Boris is actually very drug experienced. Need I say more? Now this is the most important slide of the night. And while you're contemplating it, I will just... this is a drug, all right? I'm taking it now, watch. But this is what the drinks industry wishes you to believe. And the truth is the majority of people in this country do not believe alcohol's a drug. And we did a mini survey for a panorama program we made a couple of years ago. And we asked people, is alcohol a drug? And they say no. And you say, well, look, when you drink, you feel different. Your brains obviously change, and sometimes you fall ill, you wobble around, and next morning you have a hangover sometimes. You know, surely that's all what you'd expect from taking a drug. And they look at you as if you're daft, and they say, look, if it was a drug, it would be illegal, wouldn't it? And this circularity is really quite critical in the discussions we're having, or the whole debate about drugs. And this image really encapsulates what the drinks industry wants you to believe. It wants you to believe that alcohol is not a drug and it's safer than those nasty druggy things that young people, like your children, take. So what would I say? Well, I would say a drug is a chemical which, when taken, produces physiological changes in the body. And in the context of the discussion we're having now, we're talking about changes in the brain, which are usually pleasurable. Most people take drugs because they like them, or they think they're going to like them. But sometimes, of course, drugs cause harm. And this is the most famous drug image of harm that I think there's ever been. How many of you have not seen Leobetz? So quite a few. So it's quite a long time ago. It was 20 years ago. Leobetz died. She'd done her 18th birthday. She'd taken probably 80 milligrams of MDMA ecstasy. Was under the impression that if you felt ill on MDMA, you should drink water. That was exactly the wrong thing to do. She drank 7 liters of water, and she died of water poisoning. And that image of her in intensive care went up all over billboards, all over the country, with that title, Sorted. Sorted was slang at the time for, have you got the right pills when you're in a club? So you buy ecstasy tablets or amphetamine tablets, and they'd say, are you sorted? And that advert went up to warn people of the harms of ecstasy. Now, none of you, I bet, have seen this image of this young man here. He's an Exeter University student in the golf team, and he died a couple of years ago following a drinking game after a golf match. And drinking games, those of you who've never taken part in them, you're very sensible. They're hugely dangerous because they're designed to get you drunk, and of course when you get drunk you become less good at the game, so you get more drunk and then you spiral down into total intoxication. So he died of a drinking game, and it's not in the public domain. That was in the Western Daily Press, but there were no billboards around it. You know, no one really actually cares when people die of alcohol. But why do people care so much about Leo Betts dying? Well, the reason Leo Betts was put on billboards all over the country was that two of the major companies that do advertising for the drinks industry did for free an advertising campaign. Because at that time, the drinks industry was terrified that young people would switch from alcohol to ecstasy. And so they used Leo Betts' death as a way of trying to scare people away from taking ecstasy. And what they have, to a large extent, succeeded. You know, alcohol intake has gone up dramatically since that time. And also, it's gone up in conjunction with caffeine, because what we've had is this explosion of sales of drinks like Red Bull, strong caffeinated drinks, which young people are using now to keep themselves awake so they can drink even more than they would normally drink. So they're probably aggravating the damage from alcohol by using this other legal high called caffeine. In fact, the only person you know of, I bet, who died of alcohol poisoning was Amy. I mean, yeah, all I can say is thank God she didn't die of something else, because if she died of another drug or died of tobacco even, they probably have banned it. But alcohol is immune from any kind of public criticism, despite the fact it killed her in a binge, killed an Imperial College student in her last year in a binge, and it kills lots of people. About 3 young people a week just die of alcohol poisoning. They just poison themselves to death. They often die on their birthdays when their friends get them very drunk, in a sort of spirit of solidarity and camaraderie and amusement. And about 10 a week die of accidents as a result of drinking. And the other problem with alcohol is it makes people very vulnerable. And the ACMD did a major review of date rape in about 2004. And we looked at all the evidence of date rape. We did research in 2 police areas. And we came to the conclusion that half of all date rape is just alcohol, and half is alcohol plus other drugs, and there are various other drugs, no particular drug. And as you can see from those images here, that, you know, alcohol makes women, being very drunk, makes women extraordinarily vulnerable, and it's certainly the most dangerous drug for young women. Here's some very recent data. This looks at the contribution that alcohol makes to death in people at different ages. And I'll just summarize it in the red box. Alcohol is the most common reason for death in men under the age of 50 in this country. For women, it's not the commonest reason, suicide is, but it's still very common, and it contributes 15% of deaths in women up to the age of 55. So it's a vast common cause of death in both men and women. And it's hugely expensive. It's going up. In 95, 96, there were about 94,000 hospital admissions for alcohol. In 67, they doubled to 208,000. And in 2009, the latest data we have, there were 1 million hospital episodes, 13,000 of which were in people below the drinking age. In comparison, it costs $3 billion. In comparison, ecstasy hospital admissions about 2,000, cannabis about 700. So alcohol is orders of magnitude more costly to the health service than any other drug. And what we are seeing, what we have seen in the last 40 years, is this terrifying profile of chronic liver damage and deaths from alcohol. So what this graph shows, what are called standardized mortality rates, the likelihood of any of you dying of an illness, either of the respiratory system or diabetes or brain disease or cancer or blood disease. You can see all the colors, but the red one go down. And in some cases, for some disorders, we've actually reduced mortality by over 50% in the last 40 years. But the only organ system that has bucked the trend, and it's bucked the trend massively, is death from liver disease. And 80% of that rise is due to alcohol, and 20% is due to hepatitis. And it's for people under the age of 65, within 10 years, alcoholic liver disease will be the biggest killer of men in this country. It will exceed deaths from heart disease within 10 years. Now you might say, well, you know, that's just the way it is. People are always drunk. But it doesn't have to be like that. Because here's what's happened in the rest of Europe. In the rest of Europe, liver disease deaths have fallen along with other deaths. So we are fundamentally out of step with what's happening in other civilized Western countries. And the reason this has happened in Europe is because the Europeans have actually, particularly countries like France, Spain, have introduced policies to increase the price of alcohol, make people drink better quality alcohol, rather than swill on the cheap stuff that many people in the UK use. And the reason we have this rising tide of alcohol-related deaths is because the affordability of alcohol has gone up. So the blue lines are the affordability of alcohol, and the red bars are the consumption. Now, in 1971, we were drinking on average about 7 litres of absolute alcohol a year per person in the UK. And now we're drinking about 11 litres. So it's gone up by somewhat less than twofold. The affordability of alcohol has gone up in a similar fashion. And there's a strong relationship between affordability and intake. And there's been a particular problem in the last decade with these rise of these super strength lagers, which are and beers and ciders, which are largely designed to get young people intoxicated very early and get them dependent. So this is why we have doubled more than doubled the death rate from liver disease, because we've doubled the intake, and they're very, very tightly linked. But it's not linear, it's a non-linear relationship. As alcohol intake increases, so there's an exponential increase in deaths. The other point that many people don't realize is that a lot of alcohol-related deaths occur in people who aren't particularly dependent. These are data from 2 studies in Southampton, just down the road from, and you can see here that about a third of the people with alcoholic liver disease in the 2006 survey, and about 28% in the recent survey, actually have alcoholic liver disease, but are not dependent on alcohol. So they're just people like you and me who just drink more than they should because either we don't know or because we don't care. Now, one of the reasons there's a massive resistance to any kind of public intervention about alcohol is because of this myth that alcohol has health benefits. And this is why the last Labour government refused to do anything about the alcohol industry, because they believed that the health benefits were real, tangible, and they couldn't separate, really, they said, the benefits from the harms. So here's some very recent data which does that for you. So here you see, on this side of the line are harms. On this side of the line are benefits. And the first thing you can see is that at no age in men do the benefits of alcohol outweigh the harms. Even where the benefits are maximal, in men of 66 to 74, the harms are twice the benefits. And for young people, young men, the harms outweigh the benefits so enormously that it's deceitful to even pretend there are young benefits in this group, who are the ones who are most dying from alcohol. And if you want to benefit from drinking alcohol, then you shouldn't drink more than a half a pint of beer. So I'm going to cross that threshold soon, but at least I know. So that is the therapeutic level of alcohol. Beyond that, the harms become progressively greater. For women, the pattern is almost identical. It's only in people over the age of 65 where there's a significant health benefit. And again, it never exceeds the harms. So if you don't want to risk the harms, don't drink. So that's alcohol. What about cannabis? So that, by the way, is Alan Johnson, for those of you who don't recognize him from the caricature. And this is me, judging by my moustache, you know, in the reefer he's smoking, and the just spliff. And there was a serious argument between the ACMD and government about cannabis. So what do we know about cannabis? Well, in the same 40-year period in which alcohol intake went up about twofold, and deaths from liver disease went up about fourfold, We've seen a 20-fold increase in the use of cannabis. 20 times. And this is true in almost every Western country. So you might think, well, if cannabis is harmful, then we're bound to see some very significant health harms. Well, let's look at deaths, shall we? Let's look at deaths from drugs. Let's look at tobacco. Tobacco kills 80,000 a year. So those are real deaths. Alcohol kills about 8,000 a year. Opiates kill about 1,200 a year. What about cannabis? Well, cannabis, I mean, maybe 20. So this vast increase in cannabis use isn't associated with any deaths at all. So, okay, well, maybe it does other things. Maybe it causes schizophrenia. And that's been this, I would say, smokescreen behind which the attack on cannabis has been justified. And it's a complete inaccuracy to say that cannabis causes schizophrenia. Here is the data from the best UK survey we have, the general practice database. And if you go back over the last 15 years, when cannabis use has gone up, as I say, nearly 20 times, there's no increase in psychosis, there's no increase in schizophrenia. If anything, it's getting less. Nevertheless, there is a slight risk, and this is the magnitude of the risk. We estimated that to stop one person getting schizophrenia from smoking cannabis, you've got to stop 5,000 young men from ever smoking, and about 7,000 women. And that is actually almost an impossibility, and it's certainly nothing that you could reasonably achieve using the police or using criminal sanctions to achieve without causing so much collateral damage that you would massively offset any health benefits. And we said to the government, look, you know, the risk is so trivial, there is no need to reclassify it. But Jackie Smith, probably because she didn't like cannabis herself and she was a student, decided she had to do something. And she decided to reclassify cannabis from C to B based on possible risk, public perception, and policing priorities. Now, that's a lot of alliteration, but that doesn't necessarily make for a just law. And there's good reason to believe now that this was all done in an attempt by Gordon Brown to curry favour with the Daily Mail so that they would support him in the election that never was. You remember when he came into power? There was a wave of public sympathy for him because they thought he couldn't be worse than Blair. We are naive, aren't we? And he was going to go to the country, and he went to see Paul Dacre at the Daily Mail, and apparently he did a deal with him that the Mail would support the Labour Party, something it's never done in its history, and actually it's almost inconceivable it ever could do. However, Gordon was convinced that the Mail would support him if he did three things. I don't know what the other two were, because he hasn't told us about it, nor has Paul Dacre, although it was a pity they didn't ask him at Leveson. However, one of the three things he agreed to do was to reclassify cannabis to Class B. You know, outrageous insult to the electorate. We can look at the harms of drugs, and there are many harms of drugs, and we can estimate the relative harms of a range of drugs, 20 drugs we've done here. And we've done this using a very sophisticated technology called multi-criteria decision analysis, which allows us to compare harms from different kinds of behaviors, such as international damage versus the harm to the individual. And when you do that, you see that you get this result here. And the blue bars are harms to the person who takes the drug, and the red bars are harms to society. And I have to say, somewhat to my surprise, when we did this analysis in 2010, alcohol came out on top, the most harmful drug in the UK. And the reason for that is that the alcohol has such a massive effect to harm other people. And that's partly because alcohol is so widely used, and it's partly because it's so damaging. In most cases of spouse abuse are alcohol-related. A lot of child abuse and child neglect is alcohol-related. Of course, a lot of violence on the streets. It costs the police over £6 billion a year simply to police public disorder caused by alcohol. So there are huge social costs. When you look at the harm to the individual, alcohol is not the worst. Heroin, crack cocaine, crystal meth are worse. But that vast use of alcohol makes the overall harm of alcohol the greatest in the UK, with tobacco coming here at about 7, 6 or 7 and cannabis lower down. And the cannabis conundrum is this. We know about half of young people try cannabis. Very few experience health harm. There's very little harm to society. And the last Labour Party's, last Labour government's policy on cannabis was designed to criminalise users, to deter them and to protect them, supposedly, from the harms of schizophrenia. But in fact, criminalisation of young people does very little other than ruin their life prospects, which of course then makes it more likely they get into drugs, because if you can't get a job, what can you do on the streets? Well, you can deal drugs. And it would and did have little impact on health. They also did one other very, very unpleasant thing. It denied access of cannabis to people who needed it for medicinal reasons. And I argued, and I continued to argue until I was sacked, that this was unjust. It was not evidence-based policy. It was actually a very destructive policy. And it happened. You may have been protected from it down here in Winchester. But we saw really unenviable sights. We had sniffer dogs and police in London tube stations in the poorer parts of London, pulling over young men, sniffing them for cannabis, and then arresting them. And Jackie Smith achieved her goal. She doubled the number of people getting criminal records for cannabis possession in the 4 years she was Home Secretary. A deliberate policy to supposedly reduce cannabis use, but very easy to effect, because until she came into power, the police didn't care about cannabis because they thought people who were stoned were actually easy to deal with. But when they were incentivized to make arrests, they certainly rose to the challenge, and we saw this vast amount of arrests. And was it equitable? Well, of course not. Always the ethnic minorities are easily targeted, and there's this massive overrepresentation of prosecutions for black and Asians. In fact, one of the reasons we had the riots last year, I believe, is that they started doing this again. The new police commissioner decided he was going to start clamping down on street cannabis stealing, and that aggravated the population. And then when they shot one of the dealers, the riots were provoked. And it's quite interesting to reflect back over 100 years and see where we have come from and how much we have changed. Because cannabis was legal in the UK till 1971. And then, in a completely bizarre judgment, Parliament decided to ban the drug simply because two GPs were prescribing it and encouraging people to use it recreationally rather than for medicinal purposes. Still a sort of mind-boggling decision why you ban a drug because doctors are misusing it, but they did. And that then denied access to people. And I want to go back to the time of Queen Victoria, who has a young Queen Victoria, when she was giving birth to her many children. And she wrote eulogies in letters to her friends about the benefits of cannabis. Her physician, Russell Reynolds, wrote the definitive treatise on the utility of cannabis. And she used it for period pains. She used it for pains of childbirth. And I sometimes wonder whether she actually used it other times, which may be why she had so many children, I don't know. But that was then. So here we have the Empress of the Commonwealth, or whatever it was called, the Empress, the greatest group of nations the world has ever seen, raving about cannabis. And now this is what we have. This is what the war on cannabis has done in this country. This is a true story. And you kind of think, well, why did they bother to smash the door down? Why didn't they just ring the bell? Because she's in a wheelchair. She can't jump out the window. But when you have a war, it encourages people to be violent. That's why you use the term. And this is not untypical at all. There are many people in this country with criminal records now because they have or grow cannabis or use cannabis to treat multiple sclerosis or similar disorders. Well, why do we have that problem? And I just want to talk you through this, because I don't suppose any of you know about this, because I didn't know about it until after the government collapsed. But in 2005, the Law Lords decided they were going to deny what's called the medical defence, or the defence of necessity. And they were going to deny it simply for cannabis. Now, the defence of necessity is established in English common law for about 600 years. And essentially what it says is if you have to do something because there's no other way of dealing with your problem, then you can plead necessity. And so people with multiple sclerosis who were caught with cannabis were pleading, it was the only drug that would help me with my pain and spasticity, that's why I had to take it. And the government did not like that. So they decided to ask the law lords to look into it. And the law lords decided that for cannabis only, that English common law right would be disbanded. So you can still say, I have to take crack for my headaches, or psilocybin for my headaches, but you can't say, I need to take cannabis for my spasticity. And so basically, if you're caught, you're convicted. And the magistrates loathe this, because if the police bring someone with cannabis possession to court, they must be convicted. There is no alternative. The law lords have decreed that. And in fact, you may have your assets seized under the Proceeds of Crime Act. And the three law lords that did that, made that decision, were Bingham, Carswell, and Roger. Why did they do it? Well, they didn't. They told us there were a number of reasons, one of which was it causing the courts to waste time and, you know, having to listen to all these cases of pleas of necessity. And they also said the court was influenced by the government's refusal to relax the legislation in this context, despite recommendations to do so by the House of Lords Select Committee. So here the House of Lords had said in 2000, we should have medicinal cannabis. The government said no, and the law lords decided to back the government. And you can read more about it. So that was truly the most reprehensible piece of lawmaking under the last Labour government. And it's one we've been pushing hard to get revoked. Absolutely appalling piece of legislation. But what's worse, hard to imagine what's worse is this. So when Bingham was made Lord Chief Justice in 2002, he was interviewed by a certain person called Boris Johnson, who was editor of The Spectator at the time. And Johnson said to Bingham, so you would legalise cannabis? And Bingham said, absolutely. It's stupid having a law which isn't doing what it's there for. So here's a man who 2 years, 3 years before wanted to legalize cannabis, who then, under government pressure, changed the law so that even people who needed it for medicinal purposes were getting convicted. And really, I can't think of a more extraordinary example of how the legal system has let down individuals with those kind of problems. That's atrocious, atrocious lack of humanity as well as judgment. However, there is a more humane approach, and this is what we call the Eton approach. Any of you been to Eton? I gave a similar talk once, and some guy said, no, but I teach there now. So, so these are two people. You probably all know David when he was young. This is Josh Astor, even richer, more privileged background. And they were at Eton together, and they were caught. They were caught in 1982 smoking cannabis. They used to go down to the East End of London to buy their reggae records, and they'd also pack the brown bags with some other brand stuff. And interestingly, because he only smoked, but he hadn't actually sold the drugs, David Cameron was not thrown out. He was fined, he was gated, and he was given a Georgic. And actually, the person who was teaching in Eton told me what that was, actually. He told me it was a massive poem by a guy called George. He had to copy it out in Latin. But actually, I think this is what he was told to copy. Maybe when he retires, he'll tell us the truth. But it was an interesting experiment because seven boys were expelled, including Astor. Five were suspended and four gated. So it was like a randomized controlled trial of what do you do with courts making cannabis. And Astor has gone on to have a very complicated life with a lot of drug misuse and a lot of convictions for drug use. And that's very typical of people expelled from school. If you get expelled from school, what do you do? Yeah, well, you basically hang around with people who've also been expelled from school, usually because they took drugs. So you take drugs, you deal drugs, and drugs become your life. Whereas Cameron went from, in the words of the headmaster, being the most difficult boy I have ever taught. It's incredible, isn't it? To David C., David Cameron, the Progressive MP. And he was actually quite vociferous as a backbencher when the Prince of Darkness, Howard, decided to crack down on raves because he didn't like young people enjoying themselves. Cameron said no, there was no need to do this because Sam was actually a great raver. And she still is. She went to one in Ibiza, do you remember last year? And when he was on the Home Affairs Select Committee in 2004, he said ecstasy should not be a Class A drug. And he wrote a report in which recommendation 24 was, we recommend that the government initiate a discussion within the Commission on Narcotic Drugs of alternative ways, including the possibility of legalization and regulation, to tackle the global drugs dilemma. Well, that didn't happen, did it? And in fact, when he became head of the Tory party, suddenly it all changed. His name got shorter, he became Dave, which I think is a bit of an insult, because I'm Dave. And he changed, and he said the day after he led the Tory party, he said, I got it wrong, ecstasy was a very dangerous drug. And now he's telling us that drug addiction doesn't exist, and the 2011 drugs bill wants to define addiction out of the medical lexicon. It wants addiction to become a lifestyle choice rather than an illness, which is one of the cheapest shots at individuals who are addicted to drugs there's ever been. And of course, it'll actually, already in the process of wiping out most of the professional doctors involved in the treatment of addiction by virtue of this denial of it actually being a medical illness. So where do politicians get their information from? Why do they feel like this? Well, they're clearly not listening to their experts like me, so where else do they get it from? Well, this is a fascinating PhD. This is a Scottish PhD student who looked at every single coroner's death in Scotland over the period of the noughties. And there were in Scotland 2,255 deaths in which a drug, other than alcohol, was present at death. And of those, 546 were reported in the newspapers. So about one in four. But there's an amazing imbalance in the reporting. So only one of the 265 deaths of paracetamol was reported, whereas one in 45 dies upon one in 72 morphine. A lot more interest in amphetamines. There are only 36 deaths, of which probably about 20 were actually related to or caused by amphetamine, but one in three got reported. Cocaine, one in eight. Heroin, one in five. Methadone, one in 16. But the drug that always got reported was ecstasy. And that's why people think ecstasy is so dangerous, because that's all they ever read about. The paracetamol kills 10 times more people every year than ecstasy, but the newspapers aren't interested in it. And when I spoke to them about this, because we did the first review of ecstasy in 2010, we took public hearings and the press came, and after they finished questioning me, I thought I'd take the opportunity of questioning them. So why are you so obsessed with ecstasy deaths? And they, you know, you could see them, they were a bit, they're thinking, hang on, that's my job to ask questions. But I said, no, come on, tell me why. And the guy from the Telegraph said, you know, I think it's because they're white middle-class kids, actually. They have much more interest to our readers than the rest. But the distortion is profound, and it changes the way politicians think, or at least it allows them an evidence base on which to pursue their biases. And this is what we had 2 years ago, remember, with Meow Meow, MCAT, Mephedrone. And this is probably the most bizarre phone call of my life. So I was actually in a taxi going from Barcelona Airport to give a lecture, and I got a phone call from CNN. And I'd done an interview the day before with CNN on Mephedrone. And they rang me up and they said, where's Scunthorpe? I said, why do you want to go to Scunthorpe? And they said, because the police are holding an international press conference to tell the world that two boys have died from taking Mephedrone. I said, that's absurd. You know, I mean, there have been 200,000 Israeli boys using it for the last 3 years and none have died. It's inconceivable that two would die simultaneously in Scunthorpe. So I said, okay, well, go up the M1 for 4 hours and turn right. I don't know if they made it, but if they had made it, they'd have heard Nick's dad say this. I don't want him to be labelled a druggie, because he wasn't. He was just on a night out with his friends enjoying himself, a normal, caring, hard-working lad. And that's true, but for one word, druggie, because he was a druggie. Because these two guys had gone out on a Sunday night, they started drinking at about 7, they drank till about 2 a.m. They were completely drunk. And then they wandered off to find drugs. And unfortunately, they didn't find Mephedrone, because if they had, they'd be alive. They found methadone, which is hugely toxic if you're drunk. And they died. But the media went hysterical because they wanted to ban methadone because that was something they could do. It was an interesting challenge for them, just like they'd banned ecstasy 20 years before. In fact, these guys, as I predicted, hadn't taken methadone at all. They'd actually taken methadone, the opiate substitute. And what was actually remarkable about this phase was this, the complete lack of any maturity or any evolution of the thinking. So the rhetoric that was being spewed out by Gordon Brown was identical to the rhetoric that was being spewed out 100 years before by the police commissioner in London about cocaine. The same completely mindless comments. This is an evil. I mean, a drug isn't, I mean, drugs are inanimate. They don't have intentions. They don't have valences of behavior. But this simplistic way of thinking about drugs is seen by politicians as acceptable and possibly even necessary because they think the general public can't understand anything more balanced and nuanced. And what was completely paradoxical about this whole area was that when methadone was banned, before there was any evidence it actually killed anyone, but the media wanted it killed because it was an insult to them, their power, their authority over politicians. But you might say, well, look, okay, so, you know, people aren't dying of methadone, but it's not a good thing for kids to take drugs anyway, is it? So let's just ban, why don't we just ban all drugs? You know, that would make life simpler, wouldn't it? Well, let's look at some of the sort of paradoxical benefits of methadone. And the most remarkable one was that when methadone hit the streets, cocaine deaths fell. Here's the data. Now, if the government policy had produced a 20% reduction in cocaine deaths, that would have been seen as one of the most remarkable pieces of public health legislation in history. We have failed continue over the last 20 years to have any impact on this rising number of cocaine deaths. When the free market did it, it was seen as as actually a problem. So methadone saved lives. It saved more lives than it killed because people switched from the toxic drug cocaine to a less toxic drug, methadone. And we lost 1,000 fewer soldiers were kicked out of the army because they didn't test for cocaine. They switched to methadone, which wasn't tested for it. And there was an import duty. And what was going to happen now? We don't know. Actually, thankfully, the army is still not testing, which means at least they're not going to drum out methadone users as well as cocaine users. Methadone is still the most popular drug in many clubs. The only difference is the price has gone up a lot, there's no taxation, and it's in the hands of criminals. Well, that's what always happens when you ban any drug. We've watched that happen for the last 100 years. And then I began to think, well, maybe there are benefits, possibly, of other drugs. You know, maybe actually banning drugs, the harms of banning drugs might outweigh the benefits. And this is my favorite example. So these are the people that won the two most important Nobel Prizes in medicine in the last century. In fact, probably ever. These two people changed medicine. They changed society more than any of you probably understand, because everything that happens now in medicine is predicated on knowing the genetic basis of the person or the organism. And these both of these got their insights into their Nobel Prizes through taking LSD before it was banned. And yeah, I kind of sometimes think, well, maybe we would have solved global warming if a few of the scientists had access to something that might make them think differently. And in fact, most banned drugs have treatments. In fact, most banned drugs were treatments until they got banned. So ecstasy was being widely used for psychotherapy. And it's coming back very slowly to treat serious PTSD. Psilocybin and ketamine are used for depression. LSD was used to help people come to terms with dying. And methadone and naproxen, the follow-up compound, which was also banned, even though no one used it at all, they were being developed as treatments for addiction, along the lines I've shown you. Switch from cocaine to methadone, less likely to die. Switch from heroin to buprenorphine, less likely to die. It's a perfectly logical approach, but the media managed to completely scupper those options. I just wanted to show you this. So this is an image from the very first ever psilocybin imaging study. And this is, we did this, it was a very difficult study to do, but I thought it was important to know why people get strange experiences when they take mushrooms. And one of the remarkable unexpected outputs of this study was that this part of the brain switches off. This is the part of the brain from which depression originates. And based on that, we, and the fact that our subjects who took psilocybin had improved mood for several weeks. We were able to get funding to do a trial, and we're going to start a trial of psilocybin to treat depression in people with resistant depression. And that directly emerges from the study of a drug which has never been studied before because it's been banned. However, as soon as we made that public, under parliamentary privilege, an MP said this. Why was Professor Nutt allowed to use an illegal drug in a scientific study? Now, you know, you do begin to wonder why do people like this get elected? The absurdity. But you've got to realize that for politicians, making something illegal means it's gone away. They don't want to think about it. They think that's enough. They think they've done their bit by enacting a law, even though the law actually may do more harm than good. And this really does exemplify that thinking. And as I say, they'll probably be burning my books next, so you better buy one soon in case they get them all. And then they might be burning me, I suppose. Yes. So I want to finish by just going back to a fundamental question, which I spent a lot of time thinking about in those 10 years I worked for the government. How harmful should a drug be to be banned? And what are the right comparators of harm? You know, should we actually compare harms of drugs with the harms of other things that we ban? Like, you know, driving cars fast. I think one of the most interesting comparisons is suntanning. Now, loads of people suntan, and loads of people get cancers from suntanning. They get melanomas, they get other kinds of cancers. And suntanning, you know, young people like it, and they like it because it releases in the brain chemicals which ecstasy releases. So it actually works on the same processes. The only difference is it's going to kill tens of thousands of people, excess deaths through melanomas over the next 50 years. Now, we don't ban suntanning, but what we do, at least, is stop young people under the age of 18 going and roasting themselves in tanning salons. But you know, maybe that would be an interesting comparator. If something was less harmful than, say, 2 weeks in Mallorca, then maybe, you know, it could be legal. I've always thought that if society actively promotes a drug, like this one, it's allowing me to buy and drink this drug, shouldn't people have a choice? Shouldn't we actually, if something's less harmful than alcohol, should that not at least be available in some way so people can make a reasonable choice to be intoxicated with something less harmful than alcohol? And that paper came out about 6 years ago arguing that point. I think that's a perfectly acceptable moral position. Government makes a lot of money poisoning people with alcohol. Why shouldn't you have the choice of doing something different? And then, of course, there's horse riding. Now, this is probably the most interesting comparison because it comes out of a patient. I saw in my clinic in Bristol about 7 years, 6 years ago, a woman who'd fallen off a horse some years before, smashed the front of her brain in. And her personality had changed, so she became very disinhibited, very aggressive. Her husband left her, she took away the children, she lost her job. She was struggling to live in her community, which was down in the southwest. She came to see me. I realized she had brain damage, she was very disinhibited. I treated her actually with an illegal drug. I gave her amphetamine, because amphetamine often puts self-control back into people with brain damage. It didn't cure her. It could never cure her because she'd lost a large chunk of her brain, but it gave her a little bit more self-control. And it got me interested, and I started researching how dangerous horse riding was. And I discovered to my horror, because my two daughters were horse riding at the time, that horse riding is extremely dangerous. And people die, they break their spines. Some of you may read, Melanie Reed's article in the Times each week about how she's recovering from breaking her back in two places, falling off a horse. And it's actually very dangerous thing. So I decided to do a thought experiment, and I created this syndrome called equacy, equine addiction syndrome, to compare the harms of ecstasy and equacy. And this has been a hugely popular paper with over 7,000 downloads, and some of my friends are very angry because it wasn't until they got to the second page that they realized that equacy wasn't a drug, it was just a construct. But if you compare the harms of horse riding and the harms of ecstasy, you can see that they are not so dissimilar. You can look at the number of deaths, chronic harms. You can look at other things like, you know, whether people enjoy it, etc. I mean, and there are some very ecological things. So, for instance, methane. There's a lot less methane with ecstasy than with ecstasy. And as I like to say to the police, much easier to police equacy because you'd never smuggle a horse into a club, would you? However, the subtlety of the argument was rather lost on the politician. And in the very same room in which I saw the patient a year or so before, I got a phone call within days of that article being published by Jackie Smith, the Home Secretary at the time. And there was a sort of tirade of anger. But being a psychiatrist, I'm used to that. I sort of kind of edged her round to getting to talk about what was really worrying her. And we got to this interesting dialogue. You can't compare the harms of illegal activity with an illegal one. That's her. Why not? Because one's illegal, idiot. Why is it illegal? Because it's harmful. Don't we need to compare harms as a term if it should be illegal? I put the thinks in. You can't compare harms with illegal activity. And I realised then that, you know, well, there was a problem of understanding here, and it wasn't mine. And then I spoke to a friend of mine, in the Lib Dems, who were actually very angry about the attack that she made on me, and they said, look, you know, most politicians think like her. And that made me realise that great insight, which is that making anything illegal, giving a person a criminal record, completely destroys any rational analysis of the object or the person. If you have a criminal record, you just won't get on in life. And there's only one exception to that, and that's a man called Coulson, who may get another criminal record. But we shouldn't criminalize people simply for their own good, because people cannot think logically when criminal records are there. So we must be very cautious about using criminal sanctions to control drug use. Okay, so I've been critical and hopefully informative about the way government policies and legal policies have actually been very destructive, particularly in relation to cannabis. Well, I'm actually quite a positive person, and there's loads and loads of sensible things we can do. Here are, I don't know, 8 proven approaches to improve the drug laws. We've got evidence bases from other countries, and which would actually not only improve the way we deal with drug users, but also would enable much more research and therefore much greater therapeutic utility of these drugs. And these are all, as I say, these are all proven. They're dead straightforward. Bring them in tomorrow. There's some more radical options. I mean, one of the things that I find most sad about the whole drugs law at present is that people don't know what they're taking. And so they die taking things which are completely different from what they thought. And in the Netherlands, they do it differently. In the Netherlands, they have a series of drug testing facilities where you can take your drug and you won't be arrested, and a few days later you'll go back and they'll tell you what it is, and they'll tell you how safe it is, and they'll tell you what not to do with it and how much not to take. And that means that people, if they want to use drugs, can use them with a proper knowledge base. But more than that, the government actually knows what is being used. So if suddenly a new toxic drug comes in, they can do something about it. When I said to Jackie Smith, I would like to bring over the head of the Dutch testing system just to talk to us about whether it works and how we might consider it. She just said no. We weren't allowed to take evidence from the Dutch on their policies because they got it wrong, of course. And there are other things we could do. We could make a safe synthetic alcohol. We could actually take this toxic substance and I could make something almost as good that actually was not only much safer, but also I could give you an antidote. So you could take the antidote and drive home safely after you've been to a party. Completely within the bounds of modern neuroscience. Why don't we do it? Because no one knows whether it would actually be allowed to be sold. And the government will not tell you. Because that's a bit of a difficult question. And we could make safe versions of MDMA, etc. So there are some radical things we could do. Okay, well, you can sack me, as you've probably gathered by now. It's difficult to shut me up, though. So I set up the Independent Scientific Committee on Drugs. Most of the scientists on the ACMD resigned when I was sacked, and they joined me on this new committee. It's in a charity called the Centre for Crime and Justice Studies. We've got a website. You can follow my blogs there. This is the only truly independent evidence-producing, evidence-distilling group in the world that totally independent. All the other websites either are run by governments or they're run by drug enthusiasts. This is the only one run by scientists. So I recommend you logging on and becoming a follower as well. And then I'll just finish now by pointing out the book. The book is here if you want to read the book. It's got lots more in it than my talk, but obviously it's got the talk in as well. And if you're interested in all the different aspects about drugs, and I also talk about antidepressants and anxiolytics and hypnotics as well. So it's a distillation of 40 years of treating people and thinking about drugs and drug harms. Feel free. There's some copies here. I'll sign them in the tea break if you like, if you want them. So I'll stop. Thank you very much. We'll have a break and then we'll have questions. Thank you.
Professor Nutt, thank you very much indeed. That was fantastic.